I would say the majority, it's a one-time deal. The
reasons
are probably going to be less than 15-20% of people. And typically in people that come to me with a fairly advanced condition to start with.
Is the success rate like for bladder fulguration, and what do you consider a success?
Yes, that's a great question. The only definition we have right now as for success is based on the definition of recurrent urinary tract infection. Mm-hmm. And after reviewing the literature and publishing on that myself, we've used the one that seems to be used the most, which is at least 3 symptomatic urinary tract infections per year with documented urine culture, proving the presence of the pathogen. So if you think that, you know, that's your definition to get into, you know, the treatment, then a great outcome will be if you go from more than 3 to 0, correct? If you have none, then you're pretty much cured, correct? So that's a success as far as number of urinary tract infection. And then we have a group of 1 to 2 year, which is an improvement, and over 3, which is a failure. So we use that as a very simple way to, you know, classify. Now, there may be some benefits other than having an infection and how you feel and how you, you know, you're concerned about an infection may go down. If you've not had one for several months, you say, my God, this is new to me. I used to have it, you know, predictably every 3rd week, 6 weeks, months, I would be back with antibiotics. Now I've been months with nothing. So, you know, already your mind changes and, you know, you start to do things you were not doing before. Mm-hmm. You're back to, in the running or Pilates or whatever you like to do, or even sexual activity if you're afraid of you know, trying that. Mm-hmm. So that level of improvement is harder to quantitate. So just based on the number of UTIs per year, which is a very fixed and easy outcome to measure, we can, that's how we stratify our patients. Mm-hmm. And we've even included patients who had antibiotics treatment, even with that culture-proven infection. Knowing that during COVID and all that, people could not go to get tested. So if we had to give them treatment that was counted as a UTI without the proof that they really had a positive culture. But that's, I think that's fair because that's real life practice.
Yeah, that makes sense. Other symptoms?
So you have your endoscopic success, you have your number of UTI success and your follow-up. So that's for the success. And right now I tell my patients that based on what we publish, you know, anywhere from 60 to 80% of them are going to be that group. And that depends really on the type of bacteria, the extent of their infection, as far as where it is in the bladder. You know, we try to come up with simple stages so people can, you know, understand the difference between the localized area of infection versus a spread out infection to the whole bladder, which is a different, you know, thing altogether.
Are there certain symptoms that are more likely to improve with fulguration than others?
Well, I don't know that. I think we're just thinking about number of UTIs right now. So if you don't have a UTI, your body goes back to normal. So your symptoms are gone, whichever they were before. And as you know, UTI presents in a variety of ways. So most people know when they have a UTI. And then by the time I see them, if you tell them what's your most common UTI symptom, they will tell you, you know, it's burning on urination, it's urine smells, it's just fatigue, it's, you know, low-grade fever, back pain, flank pain, suprapubic pressure. Everybody knows kind of what's affect them. And oftentimes that's their reference point, you know, I don't have that anymore.
What's the average number of times that someone has fulguration until it's considered finished?
Well, the data we've reported, you know, has been on just one time. And then we had a paper where we had to do some repeats. So I would say the majority, it's a one-time deal. The repeats are probably going to be less than 15-20% of people. And typically in people that come to me with a fairly advanced condition to start with. This is an argument, I think, in my opinion, to do cystoscopy early on. Because if you can catch the process at an early stage, fulguration will be much more successful than if you give a chance to this bacteria to grow to the rest of your bladder. And we don't understand what triggers that process, because I've seen women with 20 years of infection still with infection localized to the bladder basin. I've seen people with 3 to 5 years with the whole bladder involved. So the process allows the bacteria to go from anchoring into the base of a bladder, we call the trigone, or spreading out is not understood at all.
Okay.
But the more advanced the disease, the harder it is to, you know, control it with that technology, with that procedure.
Yeah, we were asked if it made sense to have regular cystoscopies to check for inflammation for those people that have a tendency towards chronic UTI. Do you think that should be part of standard practice?
Well, it will have to be based on data, which, you know, is starting to emerge. So my gut feeling is that based on what I know of this disease right now, it would make sense because cystoscopy is such an easy procedure to do. It doesn't hurt. It takes a few seconds to do. So to me, it's a critical part of my assessment of what's going on the bladder. Regular, I don't know if you know, you either you do or you don't have, you know, changes there. If you don't, then I don't know why you would repeat it. If you do, then you have to decide, do you want to take that into account to proceed with the filguration or just observe it for a while and see if it changes over 3 to 6 months and then ultimately decide if you want the filguration to be done. Once it's done, the only reason I do it at 6 months just to know that I'm done with the that, you know, that procedure, that bladder has healed, that normally the person should be doing well. And if that's the case and they keep having infections, I need to look more into preventive, you know, measures. What can I do to, you know, look at the pH, the diet, other, you know, things people can take like D-mannose or hyperx or whatever else, you know, we have available to help them, which is non-antibiotic based for them.
That was specifically one of the questions, was whether you recommend hyperx or D-mannose post-fulguration.
Post-fulguration, until I get to 6 months, absolutely not. And after 6 months, I would say only if people start to have recurrences again that don't seem to be related to anything anatomically that I can change. If that person has normal cystoscopy, voids normally, and they kept having infection, then obviously they're colonized. I can't see those bacteria. They're too small for me to see them. And I have to think, what can I change in there, you know, in their body to help them fight this infection? So from vaccination all the way to D-mannose or cranberry or hyperx, those are separate discussions. They all have their arguments, you know, pros and cons. We're working on all this. So it's almost a separate discussion here that we can, if you want to.
Can you share any insight into urethral dilation and whether that is a procedure that might be helpful?
Yes, yeah, so urethral dilation, it's almost a separate discussion, but you realize that some women have these recurrent infections because they don't empty their bladder properly. So that's under the category of voiding dysfunction, not emptying well. So the changes that we're seeing in the bladder in that situation are secondary to the lack of proper bladder drainage. The question, how do you recognize that condition? And the only way to recognize it is basically by knowing it can happen, obtaining a bladder x-ray. During the x-ray, when you void, the dye comes out and it is an area of narrowing, you should be able to see that. And so when you do the scope, you should be looking at that particular area with your scope. So I usually do the bladder x-ray before the scope to look at that. And then your flow, when you void, the pattern of your flow will be restricted compared to normal flow for the age of the person you're seeing. So we have normative data on that. Then we can do bladder function tests to look at the pressure in the bladder and confirm that the bladder is working harder than it should to expel the urine through that constricted passageway. So you can see this is a very, it's not something you do routinely. It's something you do because you have some reason to do that. And it's very easy to do at the time of the procedure. And I've studied that and looked at the long term, and those procedures work very well. But, you know, it's based on really evaluating the person for that and thinking about it as a possible explanation for their problem.
Because we do hear from people often that have had that procedure without that kind of evaluation, just as a thing to do to maybe help.
Remember the history behind that, since we started with the history here. The history was, especially in Texas where I'm right now, dilation was done for anything, any women. And for a long time, it was believed that that was the right thing to do. Everybody got dilated no matter what they had.
Yeah.
In the office, one of the most painful and cruel thing to do to someone. So when we do dilation, it's always under anesthesia, and it's always based on, you know, confirmation of the diagnosis, as I just explained.